Welcome back to the Hux stage this year on the Remote Congress 3. We are here again to host you an amazing talk, how proprietary IP and copyright models fail society and what we can do about it, by Mario. He will be talking about some examples where IP or the current IP system failed us. And I think in general, a lot of people would agree that not everyone is content with how IP works today. So I have nothing more to add to this, and I give my voice over to Mario.
Thank you very much. This has been a very kind introduction, and I appreciate the support of the entire team and community. And yeah, I'm happy to give this talk here today. It's a question that really concerns me for many years. Honestly, more than 20 years since I started my journey in the open source and the free software and the open hardware community. And yeah, I have quite a few things to share. But before I talk about all these problems that we see, especially this year, I want to talk about the positives, my experience over many years, how open systems can benefit society and people's lives. And I want to talk about what I experienced and where I connected to people first, because for me, this is kind of proof that open systems can work and that they are ready to be the mainstream in society. So shortly about myself, I'm working here in Berlin with my company Open Tech. I lived many years in Asia. Usually I spend still a lot of time in Asia every year. Actually, I stayed there until April when I came back at the beginning of the corona crisis, then to Germany to be close to my parents. And I love learning languages. So I'm not only into tech. I always had this excitement, this kind of inspiration when I meet people from other countries and try to speak their languages. And that's what I really love. And people don't believe it sometimes when they see my photo in the driver's license, where I have long hair and I used to play in a rock band. So that's also my life. And I believe in open tech as a solution for many of our global problems. So in 2006, for example, I started a journey with a mesh network community here, and I would like to share something that I did there that I hope to inspire others. And it's a video which I want to show you a few seconds here to get you into the mood. So let me quickly switch to the video. It's from Flo Fleissig, one video that I created at that time.
Flo Fleissig, oh la la. Ich bin Florian und das ist meine neue Wohnung. Wir sind gerade hier eingezogen und ich habe kein Internet. Jedenfalls hatte ich keins. Aber in Berlin gibt es ja Leute, die verschenken Internet. Und das Allerbeste, es kommt auch noch durch die Luft. Und ich zeige euch wie. Kommt mal mit. Hier ist mein Wohnzimmer. Kommt rein. Wie sehen die Schuhe aus?
Gut.
Und das
ist mein Computer.
Und der brauchte Internet. Und wo kommt das her? Erstmal aus einem Kabel. Und das Kabel geht durch die Decke. So, komm mit. Ich zeige euch, wo das hinführt. Das ist meine Dachterrasse. Und von hier, da komme ich immer aufs Dach. Komm schon. Von hier aus kann man über ganz Berlin gucken. Da hinten ist der Fernsehturm. Da kommt mein Internet aber nicht her. Guck mal, hier kommt mein Kabel raus. Und das geht in eine Tupperbox. Da unten. Und da kommt auch Strom hin. Und da kommt noch ein anderes Kabel raus.
Show the entire video, but I want to give you a example what I did How I got into the community, how I got excited. So we, for example, for the free wireless mesh community, and I kind of forgot that it was in German. I was switching between, but it's about a guy who gets the internet through Wi-Fi, who uses open source software, who uses networks, and like as much as possible open things, and yeah, and then like creates a network, participates in a network, and so on. We make videos about Wikipedia and so on. So actually that was a pretty exciting time, because it just seemed everything is possible. People were talking about blogging, changing the media, and so on. So yeah, looking back from 2020, it seems kind of like a utopian time, where we thought so many things are possible. And then we had like many events here called the Wizards of Oz. They happened like every 2 years at that time, and I was excited, so I went there. And 1 year I also got the chance to help with the press there, so I met a lot of the drivers of that time there. So for example, like here in this slide we see Volker Grasmuck, who organized the Wizards of OS with a team and with a community. And some people we welcomed back then were Jimmy Wales, Lawrence Lessig. And yeah, that was a really cool time when all these people came from all over the world, and like everything seemed possible, and we changed it. So and at that time I also, of course, made a video with Lawrence Lessig, and yeah, and he said something very important for me. It is extraordinarily important to have openness really in every layer of the network. The physical infrastructure needs to have open and free resources. The logical and the application needs to be open, and the content layer too has to be opened. These things work together to encourage a wide range of innovation and creativity. This just sounded so cool to me. Everything just needs to be open. And yeah, I believe in this until today. And I see that people around the world, and also I personally, we have a lot of benefits through open things. So I finished university then, and I wanted to do good. So I worked in some projects, for example, here in Berlin, at the TU Berlin, where we trained Afghans. And I also then had the chance to go to Afghanistan with a position in the foreign ministry. They funded like some training programs in Afghanistan, and I went there. And yeah, that was really cool. So I could help people in the university. We were training there. We were doing like presentations, lectures, and so on in the university over a period of 1 year. And also worked with the Goethe Institute. Later on, I met a guy who like crazy from crazy really to think of it. He started his company in Afghanistan, and then he collaborated with all kinds of organization and projects. And at that time we got in contact with the One Laptop Per Child project, and we ended up to distribute 10,000 old PCs, the XO laptops, in Afghanistan. But not just distributing them, what we actually did is we set up networks there, so the kids could have access to knowledge from the internet, to Wikipedia. And we even like did all this, like we installed a localized Wikipedia version on a computer. And so you didn't have to go all the way to the internet. The internet connection was bad, right? Like you can imagine, for example, in Jalalabad, it was really difficult to get a good internet connection. So we set up like a local server on an EPC at that time, and with a like kind of stripped down version of Wikipedia. And then we had our local network there. So, right, I mean, whatever we always talk about, we actually really tried to make it happen, and we did it. And there were so many more ideas at that time. I mean, for example, the Goethe Institute, I had proposed to them back in 2006 to make a content management system or a wiki or something like that, and collect educational materials. And I thought like maybe we could have one or two people at the Goethe Institute working on educational materials instead of like selling books to kids. And you know, all this thing where you have to like distribute books around the world and so on. I thought like we can do so much and why not start with a German institute? Unfortunately, already 2006, there wasn't any positive feedback. They said, oh, that's really nice. They wanted to hire me right away as for their development team to take care of their website. But actually, I was always interested in creating open knowledge. And unfortunately, until today, we still have the problem. The digital divide is here right now in Germany, and it's still not there. So unfortunately, no progress when I first proposed that 2006 to the Goethe Institute. So I stayed longer in Asia, and later on I went to Singapore, then to Vietnam, and I started a company in Vietnam. We did kind of Linux systems for the Swiss Post, so that was nice, right? I mean, you could earn income with open source, fantastic. And we had this idea to connect with the global community. There was always this feeling that we are a bit disconnected. I mean, we in Asia, we see all these things happening online, and somehow we don't meet these developers that we usually meet at conferences, for example, in Europe. So we thought, we are in Asia. It's not just me. I'm talking about we, because of course you're always embedded. You always meet friends, developers, designers, a lot of community people. So we thought, like, let's make an event in Asia, and here in Vietnam. We love FOSS, and let's call it FOSS Asia then, because we are in Asia. And we, over the years, we developed different activities on different streams here, FOSSAsia.org, where we, of course, then develop software and hardware. I mean, if you have events, when you have events, I mean, then you meet other people and they have cool ideas, you have cool ideas. But it's not that you only talk about it, you actually do it. You open a GitHub repository, for example, and then create a project, and some projects move forward and, become real and people use it. So one of these projects, for example, is eventj.com that we use to organize our open source events. And then, like, we also connect developers, for example, through programs like CodeHeat. So happy to see you guys there checking it out. It would be great to see you on one of these platforms. And here are a few pictures of people who are contributing. And we always have big numbers, right? But like, it's not just big numbers, of course, like people come and go, a lot of people register, but like then they come back. Some people continuously work over a long time. So maybe you see some familiar faces here from other events. These are a few of the contributors in the FOSS Asia community. So we have a lot of merge pull requests. There are 5,000 developers registered. As I said, big numbers. You know, some people stay, some people go. It's always come and go, but we have a lot of activity going on. We have hackathons, and we have a lot of coding programs. So back to 2009, then we started to organize events here with the help of the GNOME community. We hosted GNOME Asia. We started development. And that's what I say, like openness, open systems, they really bring together people to share knowledge and to build a better world. And we continued over many years here, for example, FOSS Asia Summit 2011, where we had a mini DevConf. And so we were very happy to welcome Debian developers from all over the world. That was really nice. We moved to different places, for example, Phnom Penh in 2014, where we were at Norton University. People again came from many different places, so that was really inspiring. And not just like summits and events here, also we have coding contests. And here, for example, there's an information event about coding, about CodeHeat in India. So it's not just us. People actually started to make their own events without our help. So that was really lovely to see here in India. And so then I thought, like, okay, all this free and open source, it's working. We have we have the software, we have people working on hardware. How about open architecture? And it happened that I was in Vietnam and we had a small patch of land and we had planned to build a house. And then we said, why not build something really nice, like a slightly bigger, where we can also welcome people from the community, that we can say we built an open source business here. And we decided to build an open source hotel. So basically a hotel that uses as much as possible open source tools and software, and also a hotel that should have follow the idea of ecology. So we put on top of the house, for example, water solar panels that are known to be really efficient. So the entire building uses hot water through solar panels, for example. And of course, we use a Linux system where people can go into the internet. We use OpenWRT for our network and so on, whatever is possible. Unfortunately, it's not entirely possible because in Vietnam, it's guests are usually supervised by the police. So the police demands that you install an app on the hotel computer and where you submit every evening which guests are in the hotel. So that one is the only laptop that runs with Windows there in the building. Yeah, and that was cool. And then I thought, what's happening in Germany? So I went to Germany and I met a lot of people who were working on knitting. So there were people who are interested in fashion and technology, we thought, why not bring these people together? And there was also a time where some disasters happened, for example in Bangladesh. So we had there was a building that crashed down. A lot of people died there and so on. So basically, that was big in the news. And then there was big in the news that the textile industry harms the environment, in many different ways, especially in those emerging countries. So we thought, what could we do about it? The TU Berlin and Melanie and André, a few friends here, they said, let's make it happen. Let's make an event happen where we bring some people together. And I would like to share another video here with you to give you some impressions from that time.
Computer trifft auf Mode. Auf der MeshCon kamen zum ersten Mal Softwareentwickler, Strickenthusiasten und Vertreter der Textil- und Modeindustrie zusammen. Entwickelt werden unter anderem digitale Strickmaschinen als umweltschonende Konkurrenz für Billiganbieter aus Fernost. Ein nur 3 Euro teurer WLAN-Chip zum Beispiel ins Hemd eingenäht, lässt die Kleidung mitdenken.
Für den Gesundheitssektor ist das sehr interessant, denn hier kann man sehen, wie verschiedene Parameter funktionieren. Also man kann den Herzschlag abnehmen, man kann den Blutdruck und so weiter dann aufzeichnen und direkt per WLAN übertragen.
Ziel der MeshCon ist es, durch digitale Anwendungen eine umweltfreundliche Textilproduktion nach Deutschland zurückzuholen.
So, yeah, right. I mean, that was 2014. And again, you might say, well, yeah, it's the same topics that we hear today. I mean, that's 6 years later, right? It's a umweltfreundlich environment, right? Environmental friendly textile industry. What can we do with technologies to improve the situation here? And this is something that we can do with a free and open source hardware. And then we had the CCC event again that year, and there Hong Phuc presented her a talk about textile machines, and there was this vision of an open textile production line. That's a huge thing, and we thought, let's make a revolution for the textile and garment industry. The system is broken. So already 2014 and onwards, like we already knew that the system is broken and it's just the same situation as today. And there is a video, I think I don't have so much time to show this, but we have our friends from the hackerspace in Munich and different ones. Like in this video, I recommend you to have a look online after this session, and the links and slides here will be provided. But it's really amazing what they do, and it shows that like textile production, local production is possible with free and open tools. We just need to develop them into the right direction. And of course, it takes a lot of resources. So that was one cool thing. And then we continue our FOSS Asia events, of course. Here in Phnom Penh, for example, we had Praveen. Praveen was from India, and he's a physics teacher there, and he introduced to us the idea of a pocket science lab that he could use for himself to teach to students. So we started that project, and it's unbelievable what we have now achieved in 2020. We now have a small science lab here, and you can find more information on pslab.io, and this science lab is completely open. Here you see the board. So you can connect it, for example, to a computer. You can connect it to a smartphone, and you can start to do experiments. There's a lot more work to do, but we have already achieved versions that people all over the world can use. And yeah, even you can connect small robots and learn about this. So that's really cool. This is, again, a positive vision. And we produce this in China. Of course, I always say local production, but we do what is possible. Of course, with FOSS Asia, we have a lot of connections across Asia. So here we actually got the knowledge to do this. We started a small company that facilitated the production. So that's all possible. And then, of course, it's about education. Here we see how people like go around in different places, for example, in Hackerspace, Maker Faire in Singapore and so on, and do this. And then another thing that we did, I already mentioned eventj.com. We now integrated Jitsi and Big Blue Button. It's again a positive example how you can collaborate in the open community. They are like completely different projects. We don't even know always the developers, but we can find their projects online and we can build amazing solutions. So, of course, like always, the Chaos Computer Congress here, and this is the place where contributors here from Europe, but also like from Asia, come together. Unfortunately, this year it's not possible, but we're really looking forward to hang out again with you guys. So, like, hello here from Berlin, where I'm right now at the moment, to everyone. So this is a great place to meet. So, we see amazing things are possible, and I could give you more examples from my own life, like free and open source technologies and knowledge and all these things are possible, and they can be an example. But fast forward to today, what are the news that we are seeing? We are seeing information about how proprietary IP and copyright models fail society every day. And let me go through a few news here. So, for example, here, already in March, everything is missing. That was reported on Süddeutsche.de, right? So, it was reported that we don't even have like the simplest masks everywhere. And I have to say, now it is end of December, 10 months later, and is still like, my father went to the pharmacy. He's 85 years, and what happened? They don't have masks. Yeah, so this is something simple. We are living in a high-tech country here in Germany, but we don't have masks. Yeah, and even the masks that we have, I mean, like, if I would think like 10 months have passed, what high-quality, high-tech masks could we have possibly now if we bring all our knowledge together? But it is a market focused economy here, and market-focused society, that we have a lack to even imagine something that could work with the power of community. And I was very pleased to see here our friends from Potsdam and Brandenburg here giving a talk at the CCC about how they took action and produced masks themselves. And it's unbelievable how actually we rely on citizens to take the initiative, where we have like so much money in the economy and businesses and the government. I mean, like we really need to do and change something here. But this is just like one example, and I want to move forward. Then just a few days ago, I read this here, our health minister, they have the right to the we have patents, right? Like patents to do for people do research, and they develop like some kind of formula, they develop a process. And so a lot of companies use patents to ensure they can earn money with this. What happens if there is a war or if there is a huge crisis like now the pandemic? The government is allowed to stop this. The government is permitted to take the patents and say they are invalid, for example, for some time. And they can use, for example, their power here to produce more vaccinations, right? But how long do we have to wait until vaccination is available for everyone? I mean, 6 months, 1 year, and then is it available for everyone around the world? I mean, right now, the vaccination, like it's a business, right? And the companies that create the vaccination, they don't have any interest commercially to quickly vaccinate everyone. I mean, right, you can read about it on the internet everywhere. I'm not going into detail here. There was also a talk about patents here at the CCC. So this is another bad example how we fail society because of our policies. There was also this example in the Corona crisis where some media reported that actually a company tried to stop makers here in Milano in Italy. These makers had produced spare parts for ventilators, and they were really like running out of ventilators, and that was a big problem. This company, of course, didn't want to help, and they couldn't provide design files to actually save lives. So this is just so sad that copyright and patents actually, you can only be in a loss of words when you think about it. It's like people die because of these kind of lack. And we have this year, patents are dying. So there are initiatives that actually mention this and ask European governments to follow up. So then another example, like I have a lot of examples. I don't know if I have enough time in this talk, but now let's go to examples here. The pandemic amplifies trouble with restrictive licensing and text ebooks. So of course, education is a big topic. Like students are at home, they can't get materials that they need. You can find examples all around the world. And then we have the World Intellectual Property Organization here, WIPO. What are they doing? Copyright and COVID-19. Has WIPO learned nothing from the pandemic? Are the news that we are reading here. So basically, they don't want to change their policies. People don't have access here to education, to knowledge. Even in the pandemic, they have to stay at home. It's just not possible to adjust the policies. Everything is just for copyright. WIPO missed opportunity to produce guidance on copyright exceptions hits education during pandemic. And here, for example, a quote from a spokesperson for African countries. In light of the COVID-19 pandemic, never before has the subject of copyright limitations and exceptions been more pertinent for educational and research purposes. It is just so clear. And he continues, open source publications on health research are essential to the common human endeavor to find a solution to this global health challenge. Furthermore, children in developing countries have been denied online access to educational research material because of copyright restriction. This is just unbelievable. It is inhuman to learn about this. And why did it take so long before reading time arrived to distance learning? Copyright, of course, is a quote here of Mike Masnick that I found online. And he goes on for example, teachers have to get permission to use reading materials online. And it is just silly if you think what he says here. No one would ever expect that if you walked into a kindergarten classroom, that a teacher would first need to get a permission to read aloud a book, and B, state before reading that he or she had permission from the copyright holder. This is happening in kindergartens. It's just insane. So, lot more examples, and I will switch a bit forward because I don't have too much time here for the entire thing. What else happened here this year? The YouTube DL source repository went offline. The RIAA used the same law that stops farmers, creators, and security researchers from modifying or repairing devices they bought and own, from tractors and toasters to smart speakers and smartphones. We could just go on. I think many of you remember what happened. They just took off here a source repository basically without rights. And of course, my favorite here, Apple. Apple crushes one-man repair shop in Norway's Supreme Court after three-year battle. Maybe some people are confused. I don't know who is listening. If you're listening from Germany, if you're listening from Australia or any other country, you could actually find similar news everywhere in the world where Apple prevents people from repairing their phones or from making any changes to their devices. And think about this in regards to the environment. Do you think this is good? If you can't repair your device and always have to buy something new, definitely not. The example, like the EFF just referred to it in the same path here. Farmers fight John Deere over who gets to fix an $800,000 tractor. So basically, John Deere is one of the biggest companies that create machinery, agricultural machinery. And they told the copyright office that farmers don't own their tractors because computer code snakes through the DNA of modern tractors. Farmers receive an implied license for the life of the vehicle to operate the vehicle. Okay, again, copyright and intellectual property, so-called. And just like now, I don't know if people already had the chance to go through the Brexit treaty. What do we read now in the Brexit treaty? A party shall not require the transfer of or access to the source code of software owned by a natural or legal person of the other party. Basically, this means this is here a trade agreement. And in this trade agreement, we say, if, for example, the EU or Germany, for example, demands that any software that we buy from Britain, and if this software is, for example, security related or for our power grid or something like that, we are not permitted to ask a British supplier to open the source code to us. This is like how politicians continue here in this crisis. So it's all heading in the wrong direction. And these are just a few examples. We are living here in a market society, but the market is failing to solve the pandemic, the climate change, and poverty around the world. This is just what we see here. And I want now some outcome here. I want demands. In my view, we are in a state of digital emergency. To solve the problems of our planet, from climate change to the pandemic and poverty, we need a new open digital deal for global collaboration. And this is what I showed to you before. I showed to you how, from my own experience, I can collaborate and work together with people all around the world. I can meet them. We can create something new. We did create many things. And in my view, this is an example here that we should follow as a society. And that's why I have demands and here some key things that I think we need. So of course we need global knowledge sharing to solve our problems. We need open access to knowledge and information. We can't afford anymore to block access to our books and knowledge. And of course that also means open science. We shouldn't say open science because science is like by definition already open, but unfortunately it is not always. Often scientific sources are not released, and I think many people who are working in science and in university can talk a lot about this. So local production, of course, it's not achievable from one moment to the other, but right now, like we already saw how for example for some health equipment we are dependent on other regions of the world, it's very monopolized and centralized, and for the for the environment and for the benefit of a lot of people, like locals who want to make income, we need a circular economy. That is important. And of course, like it's an ongoing topic, and I know a lot of people in Asia and in other parts of the world who suffer because they don't have privacy. And privacy is a human right, but there are many human rights that are violated, unfortunately, all around the world. Well, probably this list can be extended. These are a few key points that I see. All this is possible already today if we could leverage the advantage of open collaboration. We have a proof, I have a proof that FOSS, open hardware, open knowledge, open data works, openness works. And I want to leave you in a few moments with this list here that I created, my demands for a new open digital deal for global collaboration. It's not sorted in a specific order. There are some thoughts. I think like if people are interested to contact me and work on this, I'm happy to extend and define this list. But here are a few points how we could achieve this new open digital deal. So we could, for example, declare the state of digital emergency. I think that is what we should do. Digital Notstand in German. Like it's so apparent, it's on every corner and every school. That these problems, companies have these problems, is just everywhere. And this demands a state of digital emergency. We need a new vision of openness everywhere. And of course, we are a market society, but the state like is active on so many layers and so much money is handed out. Where is the billion euro funded package to develop freely licensed open technologies on all layers by the European Union? And we need this now. And participatory making just needs to be everywhere. A maker space in every library and substantial tax benefits for open source businesses, associations as well. It's not just businesses who improve society, it's associations, they're individuals, there are many different forms how you can benefit society and people around you. For example, I could imagine in Germany a Bundesstiftung open source, and copyright should be defined as the right to copy, not as like right now it's the other way around. It doesn't make sense at all, right? So another idea, priority for businesses, associations and individuals that provide benefits to society. I think I already mentioned that. And all this will help us with more resilience and the digital sovereignty. So we are not dependent on, like, for example, China or like companies in the US. We don't know what they are doing. And we already experienced what happened, for example, the last few years with Donald Trump. And so definitely we need to stop the colonization of Europe and the rest of the world by monopolistic platforms. I think you can imagine which platforms there are, and it's even very difficult to get out of these platforms. And unbelievably, they're hardly paying any tax here in Europe. So there are gatekeepers everywhere, Privacy is a human right, and I will leave you here with this list that you can also review afterwards. There is not so much time left, but I think you understand in which direction we need to head, and I demand that we do this right now. So this is my end slide, and I'm open for a few questions, and I hope I can follow up with more of you. There is a Force Asia Summit happening in March. We'll do it entirely online, and I would be happy to connect with you guys and with all our friends again there. So thank you very much for this talk. I'm moving back to the demands. I want to leave this as the final slide. We need openness on all layers. I'm really fed up. After 20 years, I have this experience, but I don't see that we really it must be on all layers of society. We can't wait anymore. The climate change, pandemic, maybe it's not the last pandemic, we don't know. All these things are happening, and I think we need to change this now. So thank you very much for giving me the opportunity here for this talk, and I don't know, do we still have time for a question?
Well, we are a bit over time already. But I think I have three questions right here, and I think I'm just going to ask them. We still have some time before the next talk. So are you still active in the open internet scene, or like Freifunk, or like the thing you showed at the beginning?
Yeah, I think right now I'm not like involved in the Freifunk community. But like, of course, like we all use it. I mean, you know. So it depends, define active, right? So definitely I'm supportive of the network community, and I think like it's on a lot of different layers. I try to do my part to bring the things forward. I think at the moment my main focus personally is on open hardware, for example the Pocket Science Lab, and I'm also trying to support people who want to run events with free and open source software only. We even see a lot of events that free and open source operating systems, but they use closed source platforms, and I want to help everyone to move to an open layer. And I think the wireless mesh community, Freifunk and so on, they have been very successful already. But in my view, we need companies, yeah? Because like we are in a capitalistic society. So if we try to, you know, do too many things at once, yeah? It's difficult. It's very difficult. So I'm focusing on more narrow things personally. But as I show here in the demands, I think we can have a much wider achievement if we do this on different layers. If we, for example, if we force the government to go into the copyleft instead of the close, strict copyright. If we need to change the policies, like an association by itself doesn't have the same resources as, for example, an entire state, and we need this open, free and open systems must become mainstream.
Open infrastructure, like infrastructure for everyone. What are your thoughts on Starlink? Or if there could be a way to make a kind of Starlink open source, open hardware style. Starlink is...
I didn't Musk get enough. Starlink, what is it?
Get into. Starlink is, I think, from Elon Musk, a company trying to get internet into all the remotest places via a satellite mesh network.
Starlink, absolutely. So this is a very good initiative. Of course, Elon Musk, even though I found many times that he's a supporter of free and open source, he's just one figure, and he depends on venture capital. It's not like that he has all the money and does it. He has a lot of partners, they have venture capital, and there are limits to venture capital. They want to make money. Their main priority is to make money, while my main priority is like to do good for society. So I'm definitely happy to earn money, to have like, you know, nice glass of wine and so on. But right there are limits to this. So I want society to benefit as a whole. And if we could have Starlink, for example, to run entirely with open source and like follow an open approach, cool. I would be very happy.
Last question
definitely.
For today. We are a bit short on time now. Are you more in the organization part of FOSS Asia, or are you more focused on single projects?
I think it is both. Yeah. And FOSS Asia sometimes seems like a huge organization. Like people say, oh, so many people subscribe and this and that. And we do events and people ask, how can we also become like that and so on? Actually, we don't do this to become a huge organization. Of course, we invite everyone to start repositories, to invite us to come to events and so on. But it's not like for the benefit of like having a lot of stars or something or having a lot of members. Our goal is to bring people together and also to I think it's much better if they write on their GitHub profile, I'm a member of a FOSS community, than if they say I'm a Microsoft University student or something like that. So a lot of the things that we do somehow scale because of this community effort, and one person tells the other. So even though it might sometimes look big, we are actually relatively small, I have to admit, and I try to support on every different layer. But so my personal focus changes over time. So right now I have a strong focus on enabling people to do online events, and I believe that in many parts of the world the virus situation will continue the way it is now, unfortunately, and so we need a solution to connect to these people, and
really
we should
nice
do this with free and open source.
No more questions came in as for now, so I'm just going to say from our side this talk is over. I will give the word back to you for a few last words, and then all the viewers can go watch another great talk or go around in RC3 world. So,
well, I only would like to say thank you very much to the team. It has been an absolute pleasure, and how you helped to make everything happen. It's really nice to connect with you guys, and I feel like I'm nearly like at the CCC myself. So, and I follow everything. So I appreciate all your efforts and what you're doing. So keep it up, and everyone out there, let's get on board and let's add more demands to my demands, and let's make them happen and bring them to politics and so on. Unfortunately, the Pirate Party is not didn't progress in the way we would have all loved to do it. But hopefully we can achieve this on in other ways. So please, let's join efforts and make all this happen. A new open digital deal for global collaboration. So thank you very much.